Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Crooked Castle by Sarah Jean Horowitz, narrated by Suzy Jackson. The Jasconius. The day the Jasconius crashed, the cabin boy was late for his shift. He was never late. He was never late because he loved his job. He loved his ship and every moment he spent on it, soaring over the ocean from one continent to the other. The Jasconius was one of only three transatlantic airships in the world, making the journey from London to Driftside City, Virginia, every few weeks like clockwork. How many young men could say they flew across the ocean not once in their life, not even twice, but a dozen times a year? How many could say they lived in an impossible thing, a machine great and powerful enough to defy gravity itself, with nothing but open skies ahead and the wind at their backs? The cabin boy knew he was lucky. But his luck was about to turn. That day, he was late because he loved the ship. He'd been coming off a shift with strict orders to report straight to the crew quarters and get some sleep, young man. But he knew the ship would be docking in the early morning, and he didn't want to miss the first sight of land for anything in the world. He wanted to be the first one to see it, to feel that little jolt that came with every landing after a few days over open water, the miraculous reminder that they'd made it, that there was a world beyond the endless blue below. So he nodded to his superior officer, quickly changed into his civilian clothes, and tucked himself into his favorite secluded nook on the observation deck to watch the sunrise. It was a tight fit these days. He was still getting taller every year, but he managed. He hadn't meant to fall asleep. When he woke up, they were already preparing to land. He'd missed the first glimpse of his favorite city in the world, and something felt wrong. But there were no shouts of alarm, no explosions, no panicked passengers clinging to the railings as the ship reeled. In fact, all was quiet. The cabin boy stretched and crept out of his nook, surprising a few early bird passengers nibbling at their breakfasts on the observation deck. He mumbled his apologies and distractedly brushed past them, determined to both find the source of his unease and sneak back to his quarters without being seen. He'd overslept in his hiding spot, and he'd be in for a dressing down if he showed up for duty late and out of uniform. He took a shortcut along the keel catwalk, waving to a few other crew members as he hurried past. But a moment later, he was alone, with only the hum of the engines to keep him company. The corridor was deserted, and it should not have been so. Not when they were preparing to land.
"Hello?" called the cabin boy.
He shivered. The air was chilly, but the steam pumping through the pipes in the ship's envelope should have been keeping them all warm. He slowed down, though he couldn't say why, and made his way toward the hatch that led to the engine car. The crew would be hard at work coordinating the landing. The cabin boy slipped and fell, too quickly to even reach out and catch himself. He lay there on the cold metal floor of the catwalk, a wetness seeping into his back. He sat up, groaning at the bruises already blossoming on his elbows, and rubbed the back of his head. He put a hand to the ground, and his fingers couldn't quite believe what they were feeling. He'd slipped on a patch of ice. This was impossible, of course. He looked around for any source of water, a leaky pipe, a spilled bucket abandoned by someone who had been cleaning. But there was nothing. He slowly got up. A trail of the stuff led all the way to the hatch. The cabin boy knew he should turn around and get help straight away, because something was clearly not right. But his feet seemed to move forward of their own accord, carefully dodging the slippery patches. His breath fogged in the air. When the young woman darted in front of him, he nearly fell again.
"Miss,
Excuse me?
He said, trying to remember his professional courtesies.
Passengers aren't allowed back here.
But then she was gone. Only the ghost of a laugh in her wake, and he couldn't be sure there'd been anyone standing there at all. He shook his head, like he was trying to clear cobwebs out of his brain, when suddenly his face was trapped in the grip of cold, pale hands.
Oh, don't worry, said the young woman.
She looked like a girl, really, except for her eyes. There was something older in their gray depths, something darker.
I'm not a passenger.
The boy staggered back, but her icy hands had already clawed up into his hair, fingers snagging in his short, tight curls.
You should probably run,
she said, staring straight into his eyes.
Run, little boy, and don't look back.
The cabin boy ran. He didn't remember much after that. Chapter 1. Where there's a will, there's a wisp. Felix Cassius Tiberius Carmer III spent his days learning about all the things that wanted to kill him. There weren't as many of these things as there used to be, for which he was thankful, but there were still enough to be getting on with. He learned about redcaps, who kept their namesake hats soaked with the blood of their victims. He learned about sirens, who lured sailors to their doom among jagged rocks with nothing but a song. He learned about kelpies and banshees and ghouls, where to find them and how to escape when you did, what they looked like or how they disguised themselves, even what they ate for breakfast, which was usually never anything good. These creatures all had one thing in common, besides their murderous impulses. They were part of the Unseelie Fae, and that made them part of Carmer's world, whether he liked it or not. When one's new best friend was a fairy princess, and a Seelie one at that, it was important to stay on top of one's magical education. It was for the sake of Carmer's magical education, or so Grit claimed, that he was now ankle-deep in stagnant, freezing water in near-total darkness, trying to distinguish the difference between half a dozen floating balls of light. I think a leech just bit me, Carmer complained. He shook his leg, sending ripples sloshing through the pond. He could have sworn one of the glowing orbs tittered in amusement. Pay attention to the lights, Grit scolded from somewhere up ahead. He could tell her golden fairy light apart from the others easily, though he couldn't say why. It was as unique to her as a fingerprint was to humans, though it should have been indistinguishable from the others from this far away. I thought I wasn't supposed to, Carmer protested, or else they'll enthrall me, or whatever it is you called it.
You've got to look at them sideways, like I told you, explained Grit. Catch a glimpse out of the corner of your eye. That's all you need. Then focus.
Her light bobbed up and down. Carmer tried to do as he was told, but like so many things in the fairy world, looking sideways was hardly an exact science, a fact that frustrated him to no end. He closed his eyes and took a deep breath, shivering in the December air. He opened them again, slowly this time, and looked at the reflections in the water below instead of directly out across the pond. Trying to keep his mind blank, he peered through dark lashes and the bits of hair that fell in front of his eyes. And he saw. He saw that most of the balls of light had small figures at their centers, faeries, he knew. Only one or two were truly nothing more than swirling orbs of glowing gas and malicious intent, will-o'-the-wisps and jack-o'-lanterns, who, in a less controlled scenario, wanted nothing more than to lure him into the depths of the dark water. Carmer smiled to himself. Maybe he really was getting better at this sort of thing. He flicked his gaze upward, more confident now that he'd chosen the right ones, and stared into the center of one of the lights.
Was there really nothing inside it at all? He didn't think so. He took a few steps closer, just to make sure. His knees bumped against the thin sheets of ice floating on the pond's surface, but his legs were already so numb from the cold he barely felt it. The orb glowed brighter, illuminating more of the pond. Carmer could even see a house on the other side of it. Was that the glow of a fire he spotted through the windows? A fire sounded lovely on a night like this. One more step, just for a closer look. Carmer! A streak of gold sparks shot across his field of vision, disrupting his view of both the orbs and the house. Carmer stumbled backward and nearly fell, but the muddy bottom of the pond sucked at his boots, reluctant to let such a willing prisoner go. That's enough, you lot! Grit darted in and out of the other lights. Show's over! Thank you for your time! The lights dispersed with shrugs of tiny shoulders, more than a few curious backward glances, and one or two teasing giggles. Grit stuck her tongue out at the retreating backs of the gigglers, while Carmer staggered onto solid ground. The will-o'-the-wisps sank back into the pond, winking out of sight with little gurgles as they submerged themselves in the inky water. Grit kept an eye on them as she flew to Carmer's side. Congratulations, she said, hovering at his knee as he sat down. You've just been enthralled. Carmer shook his head vigorously and ran his hands through his hair. His head felt fuzzy, much like the last time he'd fallen under the influence of fairy magic. But he was already starting to feel the true bite of the cold night air. I thought I had them, he said, a round of shivers clacking his teeth together. You did, agreed Grit, until they had you. Carmer shivered harder. The house wasn't real, he guessed. Grit shook her head. Tufts of frizzy red and gold curls escaped from her messy bun. And you should have known that. Well, said Carmer with a shrug. He tried to wring out the ends of his sodden pants, but his fingers were numb with cold. You know what they say. Practice makes perfect. Grit flew right in front of his face. Hands, she ordered. I'm fine, Carmer stuttered through white lips. And I'm a giantess, she said. Hands, now. Carmer blew on his fingers a few times before cupping his hands and extending them out to Grit, who promptly stepped inside them. Almost instantly, warmth began to radiate into his frozen fingers. Having a fire fairy for a best friend did have some benefits after all. Carmer sighed with relief. That's the best I can do for now, Grit said, sitting cross-legged in his palms. Let's call it a night, shall we? Carmer couldn't have agreed more. The next morning dawned bright and clear and cold, though not nearly as chilly as the night before. As Carmer had said would happen, their days were growing warmer as they traveled south for the winter, away from Grit's home city of Skemantis and the rest of New England. Grit stood on her favorite perch at the very topmost turret of the Motomance, Carmer's three-story motorized house on wheels, and stretched from the points of her tiny toes all the way to the tips of her fingers, yawning. As usual, she was up much earlier than Carmer. Fairies didn't need to sleep at all, strictly speaking, but with her only traveling companion in Dreamland for most of the night, there wasn't much else to keep her occupied. Carmer, of course, couldn't understand why she didn't use the extra time to study his lessons on the human world, but that was because he was boring, and she was not. Grit lowered her arms, watching the pale sunrise, and rolled her shoulders experimentally. The muscles around her left wing had gotten stiff and sore in the night, and the cold wasn't helping. She held on to the tip of the turret for support. The wind was quite strong that day, and slowly opened and closed both wings. The brass outline of the metal one glinted in the corner of her eye.
Grit wondered if she would ever get used to that. The Seely Fairy Princess hadn't always had two wings. She'd been born with only one, and it wasn't until the engineering prowess of Felix Cassius Tiberius Carmer III, combined with the perfect dose of fairy magic, that she flew for the first time. Her new wing, had it really been only a few short weeks since she'd gotten it, was a mechanical and a magical marvel. But it didn't come without its own fair share of problems, like a tendency to literally freeze up in the cold. Grit was learning to use her magic to account for such drawbacks, but it was a process that involved a lot of trial and error, and occasionally setting things on fire. Grit squinted into the sunrise, where a floating black spot had suddenly appeared over the horizon. It dipped dangerously close to the tree line in the distance before bobbing unsteadily back up again. Grit scurried halfway down the Motomance's roof before she remembered to fly. That was another thing to get used to, the rest of the way to Carmer's window. He was still asleep, his black hair tousled every which way, snoring soundly. She was loath to wake him, as she knew he didn't always sleep as well as he could. The nightmares that plagued him from their last major encounter with unseelie fairies made sure of that. But a skyward glance showed the black spot getting bigger, and therefore closer. It was teardrop-shaped, and not actually black at all, but striped in bright colors. She decided to investigate. She pushed off Carmer's windowsill with only the slightest twinge of guilt. She would turn right back if anything were amiss, she promised herself. And the moment the wind caught under her wings, she couldn't help but break into a smile. This was the way good days started, with clear skies and the possibility of adventure sailing straight at you. Not by burying your nose in books and beakers and belching engines the way Carmer did. Truthfully, the possibility of adventure in question seemed to be having a tough time sailing straight in any direction. As she flew closer, Grit recognized the shape as a balloon. These weren't as big as the hulking airships the humans sometimes traveled in, and they usually carried only one or two people in a hanging wicker basket. In addition to being in obvious distress, this one also seemed to be missing a key element, the basket. A lone figure hung directly from the balloon itself, suspended in the air by nothing but a few ropes and straps. Grit hung back, hesitating as she glided closer. She landed in a copse of trees a short way from the road and flitted from treetop to treetop, following the balloon's progress. Surely someone else would come driving along and see the balloonist. And there was a town just over the next rise. Perhaps they could see the mysterious shape floating on the horizon. They could call for help. But a needling voice told her it was still very early, and as untraveled as the country roads they were taking were, the likelihood of anyone else calling for help was slim. Contrary to what Carmer thought, she really did try to pay attention to the human world, or at least the practical bits that were worth paying attention to. The balloon passed directly overhead, and Grit got her first look at the unfortunate passenger. He was tall, with long legs currently occupied in thrashing about in a panic. Gloved hands fiddled helplessly with his harness. He looked down at the ground, which was growing nearer by the second, and then at the countryside around him, and laughed. A small, bemused laugh, to be sure, but a laugh all the same. Only a fellow adventurer could find himself in a predicament like that and laugh. And Grit was always game to meet a fellow adventurer. She sprang up from the trees before she could second-guess the impulse and launched herself past the clueless balloonist and straight under the balloon itself. "I'm a fire fairy," Grit thought. Surely, she'd heard these things called hot air balloons for a reason. Carmer dreamed of trains. He dreamed of trains spewing smoke into claustrophobic underground tunnels, brakes and whistles and other things shrieking into a dark void. Black vines crept along cold concrete walls. Black iron rails twisted with magic. The very mud beneath his feet became grasping hands, ready to drag him down forever. A three-eyed man with a dripping red conductor's cap beckoned him forward with a pointy-toothed smile. He dreamed of running until his lungs and his legs were on fire, and feeling, knowing, that he could never run fast or far enough. The train was coming for him. The wild hunt was coming for him, just as it had come for Gideon Sharp. Carmer's eyes snapped open. The image of a blonde boy being thrown into that very train still burning across his vision. He shook his head, forced himself to take deep breaths, and focused on the sound that had woken him. It was the sound of something very large crashing into his roof. "Grit?" Carmer called. She had a habit of watching the sunrise from the turret in the mornings, and at 5 inches tall, she wasn't exactly squish-proof. "Oomph," was all he could make out of the reply. He jumped out of his bunk and scrambled down the stairs and out the door. The sight that greeted him outside the Motomance was not one he expected. There was a balloon on his roof. Perhaps more alarmingly, there was a man on his roof. He was fairly certain it was a man, at least, from the look of the khaki-clad limbs sprawled every which way. Said Carmer.
"I said I'm here," said Grit,
a little more clearly this time, though he could barely hear her. A glowing light switched on somewhere under the fabric of the balloon, which had caught itself quite dramatically on the topmost turret of the Motomance. Carmer scrambled forward, unsure of what to do. The man groaned and pushed himself up onto his elbows, and then, probably realizing he wasn't actually on the ground yet, plastered himself even more firmly to the roof. One of his boots found the peaked trim of one of the windows.
"I wouldn't put your weight on that," Carmer thought, just as the decorative molding gave way.
The man's legs swung wildly, and Carmer saw that he was attached to the balloon. The hole where the turret had pierced the fabric was getting bigger, tearing as the balloonist's weight pulled it. A glowing light, Grit's glowing light, tumbled a few feet down, still trapped underneath the balloon.
"Grit!" called Carmer. "I'm fine," came the breathless reply.
He pictured her clinging to the shingles of the roof for dear life, even as the iron in them burned her hands. Iron repelled all things fae. He hoped she'd been wearing her gloves this morning when she decided to go chasing balloons.
"Me too," said the man hanging from Carmer's house. "Thanks for asking."
"Wait a minute," said Carmer, frowning. "I'll climb up to the attic and pull you inside."
But Carmer's plan never came to fruition. With a great ripping sound, the balloon tore almost all the way, dropping the balloonist down the side of the Motomance until he was only a few feet off the ground. Somewhere underneath the canvas, Grit shrieked, and her light went out. The balloonist swung around to face Carmer. He was young, perhaps only a few years older than Carmer, with smooth ebony skin and closely cropped black hair. He smiled. A blinding smile that lit up his face all the way to his eyes, hidden as they were behind thick aviator goggles, now hanging crookedly, of course. He removed the goggles with a flourish and looked down at Carmer.
"Belle Dazimer," said the balloonist. "Professional aeronaut, at your service."
And then the balloon tore from the roof completely, dropping him into a tangled heap at Carmer's front door. Chapter 2. Belle the Balloonist.
"I'm fine," protested Grit, cringing away from Carmer's touch.
Her wings were folded protectively against her back, but Carmer could see that the mechanical one lay at an odd angle. Carmer, Grit, and their uninvited houseguest sat in the Motomance's kitchen, the latter two taking stock of their various bumps and bruises. Carmer had put on a pot of tea. That's what Kitty Delphine, a girl he'd spent most of his childhood traveling with, seemed to do in the face of difficult or awkward situations. He assured himself it was just one of those things people did.
"And I'm king of the..."
"Faeries," he was about to joke, when the full ramifications of the balloonist named Belle Dazimer, sitting in his kitchen, hit him like a brick wall. Carmer stared at Grit, then at Belle, who was twisting his ankle experimentally with a grimace, and back at Grit.
"Spirits and zits," Carmer exclaimed.
The figure of speech was another one of Kitty Delphine's influences he would probably never shake.
"What do we do about him?"
he whispered. As a friend of the Fae, Carmer had sworn an oath to guard the secrets of fairy magic with his life. It hadn't been 6 weeks since he'd sworn that oath, and now he was making tea for his very obviously fairy best friend and a clueless errant balloonist.
"Why don't you make sure the lunatic hasn't broken his ankle, for a start?" suggested Grit.
"I think we can confidently say this lunatic has not," said Belle cheerfully.
He placed his foot on the ground and prodded at a blossoming bruise over his temple.
"And my lunacy is debatable."
"You attached yourself to a balloon and lit a fire under it until it blasted you off into the air with no means of controlling it," thought Carmer.
The tea kettle whistled. Carmer's skepticism must have shown on his face, because Belle said,
"Come on there, Mr....
Carmer."
"Mr. Carmer? Don't tell me you've never seen a barnstorming act before."
Carmer could have pointed out that most barnstormers were called such because the balloons and airships they performed with actually took up enough space to fill entire barns. He shrugged and busied himself with the teacups.
"Barnstorming?" piped up Grit, frowning.
"I didn't even see any barns around here."
Belle laughed.
"It's just a few aerial tricks for the local yokels," he explained to her. "Nothing so fancy as the real flying circuses. But a man's gotta eat, right?"
At that, he looked around the kitchen rather hopefully. Carmer sighed and handed him the cookie tin with his tea.
"Thanks," said Belle. "But I gotta say, I must have hit my head harder than I thought on the way down. Because was I or was I not just crash-landed by a fairy?"
He took a sizable chomp out of his cookie and looked at Carmer and Grit expectantly. Carmer nearly dropped the rest of the cups. Grit, on the other hand, hopped to her feet.
"Crash-landed?"
she demanded, wincing as pain lanced through her shoulder.
"You'd have had a very pointy encounter with some evergreens if it weren't for my help, mister."
"I had the situation perfectly under control," protested Belle. "Just got a little off course is all. It's not every day an airman gets multiple foreign objects stuck under his canvas at the same time."
"I am not a foreign object," Grit fumed.
Carmer busied himself with the tea while they bickered. It was useless to try to get any information out of Grit when she was in a temper. And Belle didn't seem particularly inclined to explain himself properly either. He picked up his cup and ventured outside to look at the state of his house. The remnants of the balloon flapped in the breeze from the Motomance's turret like a sad banner on a miniature castle. Most of it wouldn't be salvageable. Belle had been so tangled in his straps they'd had to cut him out, and the balloon was in pieces. Carmer examined it, but it didn't take much deduction to see how Belle made his living. It was a cheap trick, the sole province of two-penny entertainers with a balloon and not much else. Most modern balloons were gas balloons. They were lifted by hydrogen and equipped with ballast for ascending and a vent in the envelope for descending. But in the absence of a proper lifting gas,
Anyone could light a coal fire under a balloon, wait until it got hot enough, and bam, liftoff. The practice was foolhardy at best. The balloons often caught fire, endangering the unfortunate barnstormers attached to them, and they had no means of control up in the air. The other reason coal gas wasn't often used was that it wasn't nearly as powerful. The balloonists were usually aloft for only a short while before they came drifting back down, but the strong winds that morning must have had their own ideas for Bell. Carmer shook his head. Winds didn't have ideas. Clearly, he'd been spending more time in the company of mythical beings than was strictly good for the scientific mind. That's when he noticed the balloon was moving. And it was most definitely not because of the wind. Something was caught under the shredded mass of canvas, trapped between the wreck of the balloon and Carmer's roof, and it was buzzing? About the size of Carmer's hand, it rattled with a soft, metallic clang against the roof as it struggled to free itself from under the weight of the balloon. Multiple foreign objects, Bell had said. Grit hadn't been the only thing to get caught in Bell the Balloonist's operation this morning. Hello? Carmer called out, a little hesitantly. He knew he was supposed to be getting better at recognizing magic, but whatever this was didn't sound much like a fairy. It sounded like a machine. Carmer picked up a long piece of broken window frame, squared his shoulders, and gave the canvas a good shove. A small, white, and bird-like metallic object skittered out from under the balloon and across the roof tiles, bumping along like a poorly thrown skipping stone. It made a strained ticking noise as it fell off the roof and sailed straight over Carmer's head. He ducked just in time, and shakily flew a dozen or so feet before plummeting to the ground. Carmer stayed in his crouch, his heart pounding as he watched the object twitch across the packed earth of the dirt road. The last time he had seen mechanical birds, they'd been the tools of Gideon Sharp, apprentice to the evil, faerie-enslaving mastermind Titus Archer, also known as the Mechanist. And Carmer had barely escaped their pointy beaks with both eyes still inside his head. Was this Gideon? Somehow out of fae captivity, coming for his retribution already? There was only one way to find out. Carmer forced himself to stand up and edged closer to the twitching device, and saw, with no small amount of relief, that this object had very little in common with Gideon's ornate, realistic automata. Bird-like was a generous description. It was, in fact, a miniature glider. Once gleaming white, it was scuffed and dented from its rough journey. A bit of gold foil peeked out of a small chamber on its underside, winking in the morning sun as the glider bounced around. So this was what had gotten caught in Bell's balloon while Grit had been trying to help him. Unfortunately, it had probably gotten caught because she'd been there. Mechanical devices had a tendency to go on the fritz around too much fairy magic. And if this glider had been flying in the area at just the right, or in this case the wrong, time, well, their collision suddenly made a lot more sense. But whose was it? And how had it even flown high enough to get caught there in the first place? The glider wouldn't be flying anywhere anytime soon, not with those bent wings and the noises coming from its insides. In a different life, Carmer would have scooped it up and run upstairs to his laboratory to gleefully take it apart piece by piece. He still planned on doing that, of course. But now, he also took the extra precaution of hefting his handy piece of window frame and whacking the glider as hard as he could. The grinding and ticking noises ceased, and Carmer shook off the sad, guilty feeling that came over him, as if he'd killed something small and defenseless. It was just a machine, after all. He picked it up and gently placed it in his coat pocket. Carmer! Belle Dazimer's panicked voice came from inside the motomance. Hey, that's your name, right? Belle ran out the door, still limping a bit on his right leg.
I think something's wrong with Grit.
Carmer dashed past him and into the house, where Grit was lying on the kitchen table, pale and panting.
She got kind of mad at me, admitted Belle. But when she jumped up to fly, she just fell.
Carmer pulled out his portable magnifying glass from his pocket and sat at the table.
Let's take a look.
Something bent when I got caught under the balloon, admitted Grit, breathing shallowly.
Can you sit up?
Carmer asked. Grit nodded and eased herself into a sitting position. It only hurts when I try to extend it.
What were you doing, Grit?
Carmer asked, examining her wing as gently as he could. Grit explained how she'd seen Belle bobbing around the skyline that morning. I couldn't just let him plow into the trees, she said. I've seen the fire in other kinds of balloons before. I thought I could give him a boost without him even seeing me. But then something else flew underneath us too, and... A red flush of embarrassment crept up her neck.
It wasn't a bad idea, little miss, said Belle fairly.
He seemed to be taking the revelation that fairies were real in stride.
Then again, Carmer thought, anyone who willingly launches themselves hundreds of feet in the air for spectator sport can't be too easily rattled.
Carmer sat back.
The frame is fractured, he told Grit grimly, on the apex of the forewing.
Grit stared at him.
It's small, he assured her. I could probably weld it back together, but I worry about burning you.
Thanks to a dose of magic from Grit's mother, Seelie Queen Ombrian, Grit's wing was part machine and part real fairy wing. The glass panes between the tiny gears and wires had been replaced with actual membranes, and the device was permanently fused to Grit's back. But that same magic, while making the wing more functional, also made repairs tricky. I'm a fire fairy, Grit reminded him. You could probably drop me headfirst in a volcano.
Have you ever seen a volcano? Asked Belle.
Have you? Countered Grit. Carmer interrupted before they could get going again.
I'll do my best, he sighed. I wish I could have made it more durable. I'm sorry, Grit.
Grit blushed again. I probably should have made more of an effort not to get myself squished.
And I sincerely apologize for any role I may have played in said squishing, added Belle, placing a hand on his heart. Now, I don't mean to be indelicate, but as it seems we will all live to see another day, can I ask if the same is true for my balloon?
Carmer grimaced. At this rate, they were all going to need a lot more tea.
What do you think? Asked Grit, lying under one of the lamps in the Motomance's attic laboratory. She was trying to distract herself from the fact that her best friend was about to melt part of her body.
Think about what?
Asked Carmer, intent on the diagram of Grit's wing in front of him.
About Belle, silly. About what we're going to, well, do with him, said Grit.
She almost shrugged, then remembered she wasn't supposed to move. You've been awfully quiet since the, accident. Carmer looked down.
I don't know, he said and sighed.
Belle Dazimer had become an unexpected guest at the Motomance for the past day and a half, as his primary form of transportation had been reduced to scrap fabric.
I'm not like you, Grit. I don't make friends with every person I meet. And it's odd for me, having someone else in the Motomance, after all those years with just Kitty and the Amazifier.
Until recently, Carmer had been apprenticed to traveling magician Antoine the Amazifier. But the old man had retired.
Belle and I are hardly friends, said Grit. Or at least we won't be until he admits I saved his backside.
Carmer smiled as he checked over his tools.
And I thought since his balloon was wrecked, and that was a little bit my fault. She trailed off.
I'm nearly ready, said Carmer, tugging on the ends of his safety gloves.
You may want to,
do the magic thing.
Do the magic thing? Grit laughed nervously. I'm so glad I've spent the last month teaching you about fairy lore.
She closed her eyes and breathed deeply, focusing on channeling her magic to make herself as hot as the metal poking at her wing. She was glad of the cement surface of the lab table.
Speaking of fairy lore, it's just, Carmer said, is it okay that Belle's in the loop? Your mother was furious when you revealed yourself to me.
The muscles in Grit's back tensed.
Well, my mother's not here, is she? She asked testily.
Carmer paused in his work until she sighed.
I'm sorry. I know I messed up. But he seems to be taking it well, right?
Remarkably so, admitted Carmer. But he could also be blabbing to every soul he meets about the fairy princess in the Moto Mansion parked just outside town.
Belle had gone into the nearest town earlier that morning to see if they had any supplies that might fix his balloon.
I don't think so, said Grit. And even I haven't mentioned the princess part, thank you very much.
And she hadn't done so on purpose. This far south, few Fae would recognize her for what she was, and she wanted to make the most of it. No one had to know she was a sheltered northern princess who'd barely left her own kingdom.
But if he does talk, continued Grit, I'll take care of it.
Carmer paused, so briefly that Grit barely noticed, before he finished fusing the two broken pieces of her wing together. He didn't ask how Grit planned to take care of it, but he had an idea, and he didn't like it one bit. Carmer watched in fascination as Grit's wing glowed a bright gold, the membrane stretching to accommodate the new repair. Just when he'd thought magic couldn't amaze him anymore.
That should do for now, Carmer said. But take it easy for a bit, all right? I promise, I really will do my best to see if I can improve the design.
Grit scurried up Carmer's shoulder, as she used to do before her wing. But this time, she did something she'd never done before and jumped up to peck him quickly on the cheek. He blushed.
I think it'll be good to have Belle around, Grit said, as Carmer made his way back down to the cab of the Motomance. He'd promised to pick up Belle at the town's main square soon. At least until we can drop him off somewhere that he can get a new balloon. He's passionate about learning how things work, just like you.
Carmer thought Belle was more passionate about seeing how high he could get in the air before he came crashing down, regardless of the vehicle. But he kept his thoughts to himself.
You need someone you've got something in common with to talk to, Grit chattered while Carmer finished starting the engine. And what are the odds you'll run into another friend of the Fae who's like that? I mean, someone besides...
She broke off, but Carmer knew what she'd been about to say. Someone besides Gideon Sharp. Gideon Sharp was... had been... around Carmer's age, maybe a year or two older. He'd been a magician's apprentice, like Carmer. He'd been a friend of the Fae, like Carmer. But he'd also been a kidnapper, a fairy murderer, and a magic stealer. A past that caught up with him right around the time Carmer met him. And when he was finally free from the man he claimed made him do those things, the mechanist, Gideon had come to Carmer and Grit asking for forgiveness, asking for help. Gideon Sharp had been a thorn in Carmer's side, but he was also just a boy, a fascinating one at that. Grit's mother had said he was an unseelie changeling, a healthy human baby swapped with a sickly fairy child and raised by the Fae instead. Gideon Sharp was what happened when one caught the interest of a very different kind of fairy than Grit. And Carmer couldn't help feeling a strange kinship with him. Carmer and Grit had tried to help him, but it wasn't enough. Gideon was taken prisoner by the Wild Hunt, a horde of trapped human and fairy souls
led by the unseelie fae creature known as Mr. Moon, as punishment for his crimes against the fae. Carmer didn't know if he would ever be freed.
"It's all right," Carmer said to Grit. "You're right."
But he couldn't stop his memories of the wild hunt from roaring back. The ghostly train screeching down the abandoned underground tracks. The howls of the warrior prisoners trapped inside. The clash of their weapons against the glass windows. And then, unbidden, the sound of fairy music. Eerie and enchanting all at once. Carmer gripped the Motomance's steering wheel so hard his knuckles went white.
"Carmer?" Grit said. "Do you hear that?"
The music wasn't in his memories. It was all around him.
Chapter 3. Don't You Want to Know? Without a second thought, Carmer nearly put his foot through the accelerator. The Motomance bucked under his rough treatment, her engine not yet warm enough, and Grit was forced to jump off Carmer's shoulder and onto the dashboard.
"Carmer, wait!" she said.
But even the hint of fairy music had brought a manic gleam to her friend's eyes. It was coming from the town to the east, the town Belle was visiting for supplies. The town whose skyline was now littered with half a dozen balloons. The lilting song floated toward them. Carmer and Grit heard every word as if there were faeries inside the Motomance at that very moment. "Come fly so high, you'll touch the sky, however the wind may blow." Browning fields and ramshackle cottages whizzed by as Carmer drove faster, giving way to clusters of statelier brick buildings that made up the small town's main street. People stopped and gaped, first up at the sky, and then at the three-story house on wheels tearing past them.
"Carmer, stop!" said Grit. "Look!"
Small white balloons covered in delicate gold and silver filigree were winding their way between the buildings. The balloons were shaped like airships, and a beautiful girl in a fancy, glittering costume was suspended from almost every one. They held megaphones to their mouths as they sang. "We see that you're curious, so won't you come join us at the Roving Wonder Show?" Carmer was finally forced to slow as more and more locals crowded the streets, pointing with delight up at the pretty girls. The women were obviously human, at least they looked that way to Carmer. And now that he'd had a moment to calm down, he realized the music wasn't really fairy music at all. At least, not entirely. It had a tinny quality from being distorted by the megaphones that was decidedly unfairy-like. Some of the balloons had no girls attached at all, but bunches of colorfully painted gramophones that looked like flowers in a bouquet. They all broadcast the same song. Carmer couldn't see anyone steering them, but he had a sneaking suspicion that tiny winged creatures were involved somewhere in the equation. They were criers, Carmer realized. The circus members responsible for getting into town a few days ahead of the show to spread the word and sell tickets. But the criers Carmer had grown up watching were usually men in dusty top hats, nailing a single flyer to a town notice board while they shouted from a stool in the main square. Flying criers were something he'd never seen in his life. "We don't have beasts, and we don't have freaks. So boy, don't you want to know what makes us so special, what's teeming with magic at the Roving Wonder Show?" The girls reached into the sandbag pouches at their waists. Carmer doubted they had any true function as ballast, and withdrew handfuls of white, black, and gold objects that he couldn't quite make out from this distance. They stopped singing, but echoes of the melody still hung in the air, as if someone were humming it faintly in Carmer's ear.
"Attention!" said the girls in unison.
Their balloons stopped in midair.
"Put your hands together and glue your eyes to the skies for the amazing,
the death-defying, the aeronautic feast for the eyes that is Rinka Tinka's Roving Wonder Show.
The girls tossed the objects from their hands, and Carmer saw that they were miniature paper gliders, simple toy versions of the downed glider currently stashed in his desk. People leapt off their bicycles and leaned out of the windows of buildings to try to catch them.
"What is this?" Grit asked,
and Carmer heard the undercurrent of unease in her voice. The last time Grit had sensed fairy magic combined with human technology, they'd discovered a plot to enslave all the fairies of her city, and eventually the world, to force them into generating power for humans.
"It's a flying circus," said Carmer. "They've been around for a few years. I've heard of them, but I've never actually seen it."
The man known as Rinka Tinka, the owner of the Wonder Show, was supposedly a genius aeronautical engineer. He was notorious for being both selective about his crew and secretive about his technology.
"Arriving in Driftside City for 1 week only tomorrow night," chorused the girls. "Come one, come all."
The gold and white balloons started drifting again, edging across the rest of town and beyond. The locals were already over their surprise at the crier's dramatic appearance, and were now chatting excitedly about how they would find the time to make the trek into the city, and which cousin they would stay with, and did they think old Joe would let them borrow his steam carriage? Carmer watched as the last of the paper gliders flew this way and that on the wind. A group of schoolchildren rushed out of a white-painted church and tussled over one of the golden ones, a shade of gold that looked strikingly familiar.
"We don't have beasts, and we don't have freaks. So, boy, don't you want to know what makes us so special? What's teeming with magic at the Roving Wonder Show?"
"Well, I certainly do," said Grit flatly.
Carmer loosened his grip on the steering wheel and cracked his knuckles.
"There's something I think you should see."
Grit looked at the white metallic device on the lab table for approximately 5 seconds before striding up to the hatch in its center and blasting enough sparks from her fingertips to send the whole thing careening off the end of the lab table and crashing to the floor. The compartment fell open with a soft pop.
"What?"
Grit said at Carmer's warning look. Bell, for his part, had skidded back into a shelf of the Amazifier's old pickled specimens and nearly sent the whole thing toppling over.
"You said you couldn't get it open."
Carmer rolled his eyes and bent to pick up the slightly singed glider and place it on the lab table. Bell righted the jars behind him with a casual salute to one of the floating salamanders and stepped forward to join them.
"And you said this thing isn't at all like Gideon's evil mechanical birds,"
Grit reminded Carmer, "right?"
"I said it didn't look like one of Gideon's evil mechanical birds," corrected Carmer with a sigh.
At least, this one didn't seem designed explicitly for inflicting terror. The metal plates he had been able to unscrew before revealed a complicated network of grooves inside the device. It was a map, he'd realized, designed to steer the glider toward its intended recipient. Only this glider had been intercepted by a certain balloonist, and now its message was in their hands. Or rather, in Bell Dazimer's hands. Bell had already unfurled the tightly rolled golden paper that Carmer had seen peeking out of the glider's center hatch. He stared at it with a worshipful expression. A second, plainer piece of paper fell to the tabletop.
"What is it?" Grit asked. "Is that one of those papers the crowd was fighting over in town?"
"A golden glider,"
Bell breathed, carefully unfolding each corner of the paper to reveal the flowing calligraphy inside. "The holder of this golden glider is entitled to 2 first-class boarding passes for Rinka Tinka's Roving Wonder Show on the mythical Whale of Tales. please present your ticket at the dock at the topside hotel. Boarding begins promptly at 2 p.m.
It's a ticket, see? The criers always pass out a few of these to the crowd to get people excited, explained Belle. But the golden ones aren't just any ticket. They're the VIP experience. You get to fly with the show itself. I never thought I'd even see a real golden glider, never mind get one.
He danced around the attic with the ticket in hand, two long limbs nearly cracking Carmer over the head in the small space.
Watch the glassware, please, Carmer said, cringing. And it's not exactly ours, is it? It did crash into my balloon, Belle pointed out. I'd say I've earned it.
And I'd say it's our best chance to get inside this wonder show, said Grit, her mouth set in a firm line. There's fairy magic at work there, and I want to know why. She bent down to unroll the plain note that had also accompanied the golden ticket. Now, Belle, why don't you tell me everything you know about this flying circus?
It's not just a flying circus, said Belle, as if this were the most obvious thing in the world. They've got balloon rides and ornithopters and aerial acrobatics, sure. But there's stuff that's just as amazing on the ground, and that's saying a lot coming from me.
He stopped, leaning over Carmer's shoulder to read the note, which had probably come from within the wonder show itself. In small, shaky handwriting, it read simply, "With my compliments, I hope you enjoy the show." Carmer gulped. It probably wasn't a good time to mention that he was a little afraid of heights.
Welcome, Belle Dazimer said, to Drift City.
Belle hung out the door of the motomance, long arms swinging out to greet the approaching city skyline. He'd spent much of their approach to Driftside City nervously pacing around the few feet that constituted their living quarters and sneaking glances out the windows, but he couldn't seem to help himself from bursting outside eventually. The young man was incapable of sitting still. He climbed all over the motomance like he'd take off into the sky at any moment.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.